We light these candles as a sign of the coming light of Christ, as the Lord has promised in days to come. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad, the desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall bloom abundantly, and rejoice with joy and singing. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you. Even as we are called into the season of joy, we are called into a season of repentance. It's not meant as something to shame us or to give us self-doubt, but to free us, to set us free for a new and beautiful life that God intends for us. Please join me in the prayer of confession in your order of worship. God of everlasting joy, you call us to prepare ourselves for the good news of your presence. We ask for courageous hearts, open to repentance. Refine us with the fire of your Holy Spirit, and take away everything that gets in the way of our loving you and each other. Show us what to do, and grant us the will to do it. For we make these prayers in our Savior's name. Hear our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, the good news is this: God sent to us a Savior to cleanse us from all our sins and to set us free for a new life. Trust and believe in the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Live as new people of God. And as we come to this time of peace, we share the peace with one another, and we begin by sharing peace with those who are worshiping online. Peace be with you. We are so glad you're here. Let us greet one another. The peace of the Lord be with you.
So I didn't notice anybody under 3 feet tall, so I will share. Is Maggie here? Okay, come on up, children, come on up. Anybody else who wants to join her, Maggie, I have something for you to see. I'm so glad you're here. So last week, this guy showed up. And the kids went back to the rest of the story, and they voted if they thought the well-dressed, fancy people or this guy was going to hear the word of God. And never doubt them, they voted for this guy. So Maggie, he's back. And this is John the Baptist. And he gave us a message last week, and he talked about preparing the way. And what we compared it to was like a bird preparing for the eggs that are to come and building a nest, and building a nest that is safe and warm and hopeful and open and ready for the eggs to arrive. So I showed everybody this little hummingbird nest that we had found. But last week, it was empty. And this week, I think it's going to be hard to see, but it is filled with what? With tiny little hearts. Because it's amazing what happened this week to my heart, because I was telling them that my heart wasn't quite ready. And when I tried to prepare it a little bit, things happened this week that I felt were love being put in my nest. A friend emailed me to see how my heart was doing. Another friend invited me over to do some yoga, just things that filled my heart. And then lo and behold, I've told you this before, sometimes the radio speaks. And this morning on the way to church, Neil Diamond was doing an interview about Don't Forget Love as I'm driving into church. So my heart is feeling a little more prepared for Christmas. It's feeling a little more ready. And yes, there's still work to do. But John the Baptist today, he wasn't through with his message, and he talks to the people, and he kind of lets them know that you can't just go through the motions. You can't just say it. You can't just show up, but you've got to put it into action. And that's what he's going to be telling about today, is how do we take the love that's put in our hearts, and how do we share it and give it? And so let's go back if you want to come with me, and we'll talk more about that. But let's say a prayer before we go. Ready? Okay. Wonderful God, thank you for putting people in our lives who help us understand what love is. Thank you especially for giving us Jesus, the best love of all. Help us keep preparing our hearts and sharing that love, and be ready every day. Amen.
We have a number of prayer requests for this morning. And we begin with a joy for Matt Wygand and Dana Jenkins, who were married here yesterday. And many thanks to Brandon and Carol Cook Worrell and April Crum, who figured out how to light up the sanctuary when the power went out for the wedding. It was beautiful. And we pray this morning for the residents of Kentucky, Illinois, and the many other areas of our country where their tornadoes ripped through, and the devastation that people are experiencing with that. We've had a prayer request for Christina Bennett, who is a friend of several people in our congregation. Christina was hospitalized last week after a shooting in her own home in Newark. Prayers for Debbie Mabry on the death of her twin sister Peggy, and services were held this week. Prayers for Lorraine Buckwell, Amanda Love's aunt. Lorraine was visiting from Columbia, South Carolina, and fell down the stairs and broke her hip. And she's now at Kendall, and I got to see her yesterday, and she's recovering very well and doing the hard work of rehab. Prayers for Jean Hast, who is also at Kendall and whose health is struggling at the moment. For Tony Liska, who is a retired Denison professor and friend of many in our community. And Tony is at Licking Memorial being treated for an ongoing illness. We pray for Barb Evans, who fell yesterday and was taken to Mount Carmel East because of bleeding in the brain. And so our prayers are with her. Her son Steve flew up again from Florida to be with her last night. We pray for Beth Price, who is also at Mount Carmel East. She was taken there because of some difficulties with another ongoing illness that she's been dealing with. And our prayers for Susan Freeman, who suffered a major stroke on Wednesday and was taken to Mount Carmel as well. And Susan's family made the difficult decision on Friday to move her to palliative care. And so we pray for Susan's comfort and rest as she enters this final stage of her incredible life. And we pray for strength for her husband, Chip, and for their children, Julie, Chris, Laura, and Dave, and for their spouses and for the grandkids as they process this transition. As we offer our prayers this morning, I invite you to respond when I say we pray to the Lord. Respond, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Loving God, we are holding so much in our hearts this morning. For our world, for our church, and especially for these people we love. Bring peace, O Lord, to this world you have made, and to these people and families we hold dear. We ask for your healing power to be with those who are sick, that they may be strengthened in body, mind, and spirit, and be made whole. Help them to accept what cannot be mended. Give them the courage to do the hard work of recovery where it is possible. And grant them the wisdom to know what to do. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are dying, that their final journey may be peaceful, that they may feel the love of family and friends around them, and that they may know your powerful presence as you welcome them home. Be with those who watch and wait, keeping vigil by their sides. Grant them your mercy and your peace. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those who struggle in this season with the weight of grief and longing for someone who's gone. Comfort them when tearful memories come. Help them be gentle with themselves and kind. Bring moments of lightness and maybe even laughter to their days as well. Help those around them to be present with kindness and understanding. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. And help us to be mindful in our own lives, Lord, of the wonder of love that we cannot take for granted, for the beauty of moments to treasure, for the relationships that bring us joy and the work that brings us meaning. Help each of us in our own families and communities to nurture love and compassion for one another. And fill us with such faith that we can be sturdy in our challenges, joyful in our living, and confident of your everlasting love. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For we make these prayers in Jesus' name, as we say together the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As God has offered himself to us in Jesus Christ, so we offer ourselves to God and to one another in the offering that we give each week. We don't pass plates anymore, but we do have plates in the back and at the doors, and so if on your way out you decide to give, that would be lovely and generous. There's a way to give online as well. And I know many people give in a host of different ways. And if you're able to pledge, we always encourage that as well. But most of all, as we listen to the offering this morning, Consider the love that you are being asked to give to those around you. Our scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3, beginning in verse 7. It is, as Ellen explained, the continuation of last week's passage about John the Baptist, who was considered the forerunner of Jesus. Listen again for God's word to you today. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." "What should we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none. And anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Don't collect any more than you are required to, he told them. And then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money, and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So one of the resources that I turn to sometimes for sermon preparation is a blog from a group called The Salt Project. And this week's reflection I found particularly helpful. For starters, they point out the strange tension, the juxtaposition of the beginning of the passage, you brood of vipers, and the end, that this proclamation is good news. You brood of vipers, good news. How is that kind of challenge good news? This is what they say. First, John's challenge itself is dignifying, since it presumes that we have the capacity to rise and meet it, to become the even more generous, honest, respectful people God has created us to be. In other words, God believes in us even more than we believe in ourselves. And John was bringing that message. Second, they say, because John's challenge is open to all, not just a privileged few, the divine covenant is open to all in an astounding, inspiring way, even to people like tax collectors, which means that it's probably open to, say, everybody here. And third, because John's prophetic poetry includes the promise that the Spirit comes in wind and fire, not to destroy, but to refine, to restore, to make us more radiant children of God. But, they go on to say, it's not free, in that we have work to do. We have to let go. We have to let go of our anxieties, our self-absorption, our apathy, our sin. And all of that will be burned away in God's unquenchable fire. But the chaff is removed for the sake of the wheat. Jesus comes so that we might be saved and restored. And that is the good news of great joy for all people. I thought that was so helpful. But then I started to look at what John tells them to do, and I find this so interesting, because it's not about being like super religious. It's not about being super pious. It starts with something really simple. It starts with sharing what we have. If you have two coats, share one. If you have enough food, share that. And to share, it seems to me, starts with being content with what we have. Don't take more than you need. Give away what you have that's excess. It begins with seeing our own world as enough. It begins with how we see our own lives. The writer Parker Palmer observes this. He says, it requires no special talent or effort to look at our world and point out the things that numb us or dumb us down or depress us. In fact, he says, it's a no-brainer. But becoming keenly and consistently aware of what's good and true and beautiful and life-giving around us and within us demands a discipline that we must open our eyes and minds and hearts, and we must keep them open. We must see. So, another way to put it is that to become the more generous, honest, respectful people that God created us to be, it has to start with how we see the world. It has to start with how we see our own lives. So I've come to think of it this way, and I hope this doesn't sound a little bit crazy. I have come to see that it's like we've got these multiple voices in our heads, and they're each telling us a different story about the way the world is, or the way that life is, or the way that my life is, the way things are. And each one of those voices is competing for our attention. One voice might tell us that we are strong, capable people. One voice might tell us, look at how much love there is in the world. Doesn't that feel wonderful? And one voice might tell us, you know, the world really can't be trusted. And one voice might be like a little child who's afraid they're going to get caught, so they hide. And another is like a little kid who wants to grab all the goodies for themselves and hoard it. That's like our greedy, selfish part. Does that make any sense at all? I've seen a few people. At least that's what happens in my mind. So with all those voices, with all those different thoughts rolling around, all those different perspectives that are fighting for our attention, how do we become the generous and loving people that God created us to be, the one John the Baptist is talking about? I think it starts by turning up the volume on what is best and not what is worst. It reminds me of the Mary Oliver poem that's part of the Advent devotionals that some of us are using this year. This week featured a poem called Mindful. Jane read it for a devotion at a meeting recently, and I just loved hearing it. This is what Mary Oliver wrote. She said, every day I see or I hear something that more or less kills me with delight, that leaves me like a needle in the haystack of light. It is what I was born for, to look, to learn, to listen, to lose myself inside this soft world, to instruct myself over and over in joy and acclimation, to instruct myself over and over in joy. She says, I'm not talking about the exceptional, the fearful, the dreadful, the very extravagant, but the ordinary, the common, the very drab, the daily presentations. Oh, good scholar, I say to myself, how can you help but grow wise with such teachings as these? The untrimmable light of the world, the ocean's shine, the prayers that are made out of grass. What do we see? Now, I have to admit that as I was writing this sermon, it almost felt jarring to put those words in this place on this particular day when I'm so exquisitely aware of how much pain there is in other people's lives. Sometimes it feels almost tone deaf to preach joy when there is so much suffering and difficulty going on around us. But then I think maybe that's when we need to hear it most. And I'm not talking, just to be clear, I'm not talking about always look on the sunny side of life, right? I'm not talking about seeing the glasses half full. We don't do ourselves any favors by avoiding grief or pain. We have to go through them. We have to work through them. We have to process them, metabolize them, as some would say. It's almost like the process of honest grieving allows us to clear the glass enough to see things as they really are. But I have to tell you that even this last week, in the midst of tears of sadness, my heart was so full because of what I saw. I saw a husband courageously leading his family through painful, difficult decisions with strength and love and respect. I saw siblings each taking their role in the family, doing what they do best to support each other, not jockeying for position, but supporting each other. Sometimes even joking about how different they are. I saw hospital workers patiently sharing information, honoring decisions, giving space, mindfully guiding. I saw tender and deep moments full of the Spirit of God. And I saw a wedding here yesterday, a beginning. A couple who wanted to bring the best out in each other, and they're doing it. A couple keeping their eyes on the prize even when the power went out on their special day, the day they've been planning forever. And I saw a congregation full of family and friends there to support them, and people coming together from all walks of life, and so present, and so ready to be thankful to God for love. Now, this may sound really odd to say, but I have so much more appreciation for John the Baptist's message this year than I ever have. Because it's not just about sharing what we have or not being selfish. This isn't a morality lesson. You go do this and you'll be fine. Though of course those are basic truths, of course we should share. But it is so much more. It's what we see around us and how we see the world, and especially how we see our own lives. That's what gives us the power to change our lives. Do we believe we have enough to share? Do we see abundance or scarcity? And it's even more than that. Do we believe that Jesus has the ability to clear the lens of how we see? So that what we are seeing changes. Do we trust in Jesus to clear the wheat from the chaff? Do we trust in Jesus to help us know we have enough? We are enough with God's help. This truly is a message of good news, of new beginnings, through the power of the Spirit. The Spirit that is sent not to destroy, but to refine and restore, to help us to become those generous, honest, respectful people that God created us to be. John begins by calling out the way things are, which is the only way we can ever start this journey. And he offers a path that leads to joy. Things that were murky become clearer when we are seeing with God's own heart. May you be open to that insight. And may that refiner's fire come to you. Thanks be to God.
Please join in the prayer of dedication found in your order of worship. Dear God, baptize us with your Holy Spirit and fire so that we might become more like Jesus, more hopeful, peaceful, joyful, kind, bold, and always glad to share our coats, our food, our blessings with our neighbors near and far. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have a few announcements for today I'd like to share with you, and a bunch of them are on the back of your order of worship, so I want to call your attention there. Immediately after worship this morning, we have a chance for anybody who's visiting or who's been connecting a little bit but would like to connect more to meet with me and each other and a couple of friends in the library right down the hall. We're calling it Pastries with the Pastor. So you're welcome to come. I would love to get to know you more. Children's Choir and Faith Formation is gathering in the youth music room. Coffee Fellowship downstairs, which is so nice to be able to do again. Families and Faith is meeting downstairs in the East Lounge. And the PRISM discussion group meets at 9 o'clock on Sunday mornings, and so you're welcome to come to that next week or to access online as well. Christmas order poinsettia order forms are due tomorrow, so if you'd like to order a poinsettia to dedicate in to someone or in someone's memory, there are forms by the entrances and I believe online as well. There is a parents' night out coming on the 20th from 5:30 to 7:30 for parents of kids kindergarten through sixth grade. The kids will have dinner and share the Christmas story and make family nativities, and the parents will have some time to themselves. So spread the word on that. And finally, we are looking for folks to serve as liturgists and ushers. And if you are interested in doing that, please let one of us know. You can email Doris or me, or just let me know following worship. Lots of ways to be part of our worship together. As we go out into the world, we have been given so much. We just need eyes to see it. And that's what Jesus offers us. So let's go out with open eyes to see the abundance of love that we have been given, so that we can go out in joy and share what we have received. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.